Simon & Schuster Audio presents Kill Shot by Vince Flynn. Read by Armand Schultz.
The man flew through the air, propelled by one of the other recruits. CIA handler Irene Kennedy watched from inside the house with casual interest as he failed to tuck and roll. He hit the ground flat and hard, the kind of impact that more than likely knocked the wind out of him, maybe even bruised a rib. Kennedy pursed her lips and calculated his odds of making it through the remaining 8 weeks of the training program. She'd seen so many men roll through here that she could handicap them like a Vegas bookie. This one, she gave less than a 10% chance. Kennedy's thoughts, however, were not really with this batch of recruits. She was more concerned with a certain man who had waltzed through the rigorous training program a little more than a year ago. Mitch Rapp had been her rookie, and in the year since they had unleashed him on the purveyors of terrorism, he had left a steady trail of bodies from Geneva to Istanbul to Beirut and beyond. His record to date was perfect, and that in its own way added to Kennedy's tension. No one was perfect. Sooner or later, no matter how much talent they had, they might get tripped up. To complicate the odds, Kennedy had pushed to allow Rapp to operate on his own. Instinctively, she liked the simplicity. She'd seen more than her fair share of operations that had become so cumbersome in personnel and scope that they never got off the ground. This mission was different, though. The stakes were considerably higher. It was one thing when Rapp was lurking about some third-world country practicing his craft, but at this very moment, he was about to do something very illegal and unsanctioned in a country where he could not afford to make even the slightest mistake. So intense was Kennedy's concentration that she hadn't heard the question from the man sitting behind the desk. She brushed a strand of her shoulder-length auburn hair behind her ear and said, "Excuse me?" Dr. Lewis had been studying her for the last few minutes. "You're worried about him," he stated. Irene Kennedy's face remained neutral, despite the fact that she was irritated by her colleague's ability to read her thoughts.
"Who? I worry about every operation I'm in charge of."
"It seems you worry more about the ones he's involved in." Kennedy considered the unique individual whom she had found in upstate New York. As much as she'd like to deny it, Lewis's assessment of her concern over Rapp was accurate.
"I'm his handler. I put him in these situations, and I'm his only lifeline should something go wrong. I would think that clinically, even you would understand that."
The shrink stroked his bottom lip with his forefinger and said,
"Worrying about someone or something can be normal, even healthy, but if taken too far, definitely not good."
Here we go, Kennedy thought to herself. This was not an accidental conversation. Lewis had been thinking about this for some time, plotting his line of questioning.
"So you think I worry too much?"
"I didn't say that," the doctor said, with an easy tone and a soft shake of his head.
"But you implied it," Kennedy said. "And I would appreciate it if you would explain yourself rather than treat this like one of your therapy sessions."
Lewis sighed. He'd seen Kennedy get this way, but never with him. Usually it was with Stan Hurley, who was exceedingly adept at getting under people's skin.
"I think when it comes to a certain operative, you worry too much."
"Rapp?" Kennedy asked.
"Correct." "Please don't give me some psychobabble that you think I'm in love with him."
Kennedy shook her head as if anything so humdrum was beneath her.
"You know that's not how I work."
Lewis dismissed the idea with the back of his hand.
"I agree. That's not my concern." "Then what is?"
"That you do not give the man his credit."
"Credit? Credit for what?"
"Well, let's start with the fact that he came down here a little more than a year ago, without any military experience, and bested every man we put in front of him, including your Uncle Stan.
His ability to learn, and do so at an incredibly rapid pace, is unlike anything I have ever seen. Mitch Rapp is a one-man wrecking ball. He has methodically, in a little over a year, accomplished more than we have accomplished in the last decade. And let's be brutally honest with each other. He is exceedingly good at hunting down and killing men.
Kennedy did not look at Lewis, but she nodded. They had all come to the same realization months ago. That was why they had turned him loose and allowed him to work on his own.
"I'm here," Lewis continued, "to observe and make sure we have the right people and that their minds can handle the unique stress of this job. I have stress, you have stress, but I doubt ours compares to the stress of operating alone, often behind enemy lines, and hunting down a man and killing him."
"So you're worried that he's going to snap on us?"
"Not at the moment. He is a linear creature, which means he doesn't allow a lot of ancillary issues to muddy the waters of his conscience. These men, the ones we target, they all decided of their own volition to get involved in plots to kill innocent civilians. In Rapp's mind, and this isn't me guessing, he's expressed this very clearly. These men need to be punished."
Kennedy shifted in her chair.
"Simple revenge?"
"He says retribution. The distinction is slight, but I see his point."
"Well, given the loss of his girlfriend," Kennedy said, "I don't find his attitude particularly troubling. After all, this is a job that requires a unique motivation."
"Yes, it does, but his feelings run deep. He thinks if these men go unpunished, it will only embolden them to kill more people, to screw up more people's lives."
"You'll get no argument from me, nor our boss, for that matter."
Lewis smiled.
"There's one more thing, something that adds a unique twist."
"What's that?"
"He wants them to know he's coming after them."
"He told you this?" Kennedy asked, more than a bit surprised.
"Parts of it.
The rest I pieced together."
"And why didn't you tell me?"
"I'm telling you right now." Kennedy moved to the edge of her chair.
"I mean, why didn't you tell me when you first learned about it?"
"I told Thomas," Lewis said, covering his bases.
"And what did he say?"
"He thought about it for a long moment, and then said making these guys lose a little sleep might not be the worst thing."
"For Christ's sake."
Kennedy pressed her palm against her forehead.
"As his handler, don't you think you should let me in on stuff like this?"
"I'm not sure I understand your concern. I think he's fine, and Thomas does as well." Kennedy pinched the bridge of her nose in an effort to stifle the headache she felt coming.
"This isn't the NFL. We don't trash talk. We don't taunt the other team in order to throw them off their game. My men need to be ghosts. They need to sneak into a country, quietly do their job, and then disappear."
"Irene, I think you are exaggerating your concerns. The enemy knows something is afoot. Bodies are piling up at an unusual clip, and if the fear Rapp is generating causes some of these men to be a bit jumpy," Lewis shrugged,
"well, then so be it."
"So what in the hell are you trying to tell me? That you're okay with Rapp, but you're worried about me?"
Kennedy asked, the suspicion in her voice obvious. "I'm okay with both of you, but I do think you worry too much."
"I'm worried about him because he's about to kill a high-ranking official in the capital of one of our closest allies. If he screws up, the blowback could be so bad, every single last one of us will end up in front of a committee on Capitol Hill, be indicted, and then end up in jail."
"My point, Irene, is that Rapp is good, maybe the best I've ever seen, and his target is a lazy, overfed bureaucrat. Tonight, we'll go fine. That's not what I'm worried about." Kennedy was so focused on Paris that she almost missed the last part.
"Then what are you worried about?"
"Mr. Rapp is unique. He has already proven his penchant for autonomy. He bristles against control. And so far, Thomas has been willing to ignore all of these little transgressions because the man is so damn good at what he does."
"But?"
"Our country and our beloved employer have a glorious history of throwing those at the tip of the spear under the proverbial bus when things get difficult. If they do that to a man like Rapp..." Lewis winced at the thought. Paris, France. Rapp secured the gray nylon rope to a cast-iron vent stack and walked to the edge of the roof. He glanced at the balcony two floors below and then looked out across the city of light. Sunrise was a few hours off, and the flow of late-night revelers had faded to a trickle. It was that rare moment of relative inactivity that even a city as vibrant as Paris...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.